Schliemann's theory was simple. The travel writer Pausanias said that Agamemnon and his murdered companions were buried within the walls. It was always assumed that he meant the outer walls of the lower city, but Schliemann thought they'd been buried inside the citadel itself. The scholars, as usual, laughed, but in the autumn of 1876, he started a great trench just inside the Lion Gate, across a terraced area which looked as if it had been leveled long ago. Immediately, he came across a circle of standing stones. Inside it were what looked like the remains of tombstones carved with chariots and fighting men. He dug deeper and found the tops of five shafts sunk into the bedrock. At the bottom were some of the greatest finds ever made in archaeology. In those shafts were the remains of bronze-clad royalty from the heroic age, men, women, and children. They were literally covered in gold. Here too were the first signs seen by modern man of a heroic world which might be reflected in Homer's Iliad. Studded swords like the one Hector gave to Ajax. A dagger blade inlaid with a scene showing tower shields like those described by Homer. There were wonderfully worked gold ornaments covering the head and chest. Extraordinary finger rings, exquisitely engraved. For Schliemann, there was no doubt that he had discovered here in the shaft graves the world of Homer, the world of the Iliad. Everything fitted. Pausanias had said there were five graves, and Schliemann had found five graves. The legend had even required Cassandra's two babies to be buried with her, and Schliemann had found two infants, leafed in gold. But here in the fifth grave, as with the jewels of Helen at Troy, Schliemann found what he had above all wished to find. There were three male bodies down there, with gilt war gear, gold adornments on their breasts, and gold masks. When the mask was lifted off the first one, the skull crumbled into dust. The same happened with the second one. But with the third one, when the mask was lifted, as Schliemann himself tells the story, the round face, with all its flesh, was wonderfully preserved underneath the ponderous golden mask. There was no trace of hair, but the eyes were perfectly visible, and the mouth was wide open owing to the great weight pressed upon it, revealing 32 beautiful teeth, which led the physicians who came to examine the body to believe that the man had died at the early age of 35. Schliemann, so the story has it, picked up the mask and kissed it. And that evening he sent the king of Greece a telegram. I have gazed upon the face of Agamemnon. But he resolved to go back once again the following year, hoping he could still solve the riddle. It is not too late, he wrote. But the gods, as he would have said, did not allow it.
On Christmas Day 1890, he died in Naples, worn out by Troy itself. He was taken back to his beloved Athens, his adopted home, for burial. Schliemann's tomb lies in the first cemetery of Athens, adorned with sculpted scenes of the heroes Hector and Achilles fighting in front of sacred Ilios. Alongside them in death, that latter-day hero Schliemann himself, Homer in hand, Sophie devoted by his side, together conquering new worlds for the imagination. Schliemann's house still stands in Athens. His ghost is still there too. "To make my beloved Greece live again," he said, "all I did was to that end." The new science of archaeology did not escape such feelings. How could it? In a sense, it is the most romantic of sciences, for we would have it physically restore to us the lost past. "My work," he wrote, "will remain as long as there are admirers of Homer in the world, nay, as long as this globe will be inhabited by men. Know yourself." That Homer's tale was, after all, the truth.